and welcome back to another episode of Twisted Talks. I'm Tanya.
I'm Josh.
And today is Josh's turn to tell us a story, a true crime case.
Yeah, there we go.
Phrase that kind of strangely, but anyway.
It's that kind of day.
I get to sit back, relax and listen.
And yes, so this episode takes us to number 55, Boulevard Robert Schumann in Nantes, France, to the case of the Dupont de Ligonnès family. This house was located...
Parle français?
Poquito, he says in Spanish. But I'm located in the, I think, eastern suburbs of the city. But anyway, it's in the suburbs of the city. The family consisted of Xavier Dupont de Ligonnès, his wife Agnès, their four children, Arthur, Thomas, I don't know, is it Thomas or Tomas, Anne and Benoit.
Benoit.
I love that name.
What a good name.
Going back in the history of the Dupont de Ligonnès family, they come from an old aristocratic family that were originally from Annonay in southeastern France. Don't know if I'm pronouncing that right, but I'm trying. An aristocratic family is a family that is in the highest class in certain societies. So
very upper class.
Yes, very socially admirable.
They're rich.
Yes. Now, that's, like I said, though, that's going back. Obviously, you know, this is a relatively modern case, so it's, you know, we wouldn't really... What in the name of God is that? I don't know if the microphone pick it up, but anyway. So I wouldn't really pay much heed to the, in my opinion, pay much heed to the aristocratic status in this case, because there doesn't seem to be much mention to do with that or any kind of pointer towards them being... still high up or anything, so I just mentioned that for the sake of historical, like in the past, their ancestors and parents and whatnot, or at least Xavier's anyway, because that's the Dupont de Ligonnès side. So Xavier was born on the 9th of January 1961 in Versailles. He was described as a salesman in his professional life by a source close to the inquiry, but his professional activities were very, very vague.
Okay.
Xavier started multiple businesses, most of which with limited success. Most of these businesses catered for travelling salespeople and restaurant guests. Agnès Dupont de Ligonnès, maiden name Agnès Hodanger, I'm not sure if I'm pronouncing that right.
Let me see.
Was born on the 9th of November 1962.
That's my birthday.
In, I hope not 1962.
No, 2002.
Not that there's anything wrong with 1962. And she was born in the suburbs of Paris, oui Paris. She was an assistant at Blanche de Castile Catholic School in Nantes and was described as being very religious, and she regularly went to mass with her children.
Oh.
People from the church described her as kind but strict with the children. And then moving on to Agnès and Xavier's children, Arthur was born on the 7th of July 1990 and had a different father, but Xavier saw Arthur as his own.
Okay.
Arthur was 2 years old when Xavier and Agnès got married, so, you know, on the scene practically his entire life.
Yeah, so basically was his dad.
Like, you know, yeah. Arthur had earned a bachelor's in science, industrial technology and sustainable development at the age of 20.
I just ripped a hole in my pants.
Why not?
Oops.
Tread carefully.
Yep. Or rip the thread out. Sorry.
Exactly.
Continue.
The pants have distracted. Continue, I will.
I don't even know if that's French.
Neither do I. He was studying for a technical diploma in IT at a private college an hour away from Nantes. I just think, like, fair play having your bachelor's at 20.
Yeah.
I don't know, is that a normal thing? Dropout vibes and all that, you know, didn't finish, so maybe that is normal age to have it, but either way, well done. But he was also working as a waiter at a pizzeria in Nantes as well.
Okay.
Then Thomas was born on the 28th of August 1992, and he had earned a bachelor
What's
in literature. What's with all the...
It's my sister's birthday, my mum's birthday, continue.
It's strange. He had earned a bachelor in literature at 17 years old. Now, well done on that one, because I'm definitely pretty sure that's not normal.
They've got good heads on their shoulders.
Yeah. You know, fair play.
Me.
Same. He was also passionate about music and studied it at Catholic University in Angers. Thomas was described as an ordinary boy whose family accompanied him to drop him off and pick him up. So several of his classmates also described him as very discreet.
Discreet. Okay.
Interesting.
So does that mean maybe he was like just kind of private?
Sounds like most of the people on Grindr.
Yeah.
I would assume, yeah, quiet and kept to himself.
Okay, kind of reserved.
Yes, not very open about his business, I guess. Anne was born on the 2nd of August 1994 and was in 11th grade following an academic curriculum in science.
Okay.
She was described by friends and relatives as someone who shared her mother's religious beliefs, was considerate and approachable. And then Benoit, the youngest, was born on the 29th of May 1997,
mm-hmm.
Making him Agnès and Xavier's youngest child. He was an altar server at a church. In Nantes as well. In April 2011, relatives of the family, so this is kind of where we're, you know, we're getting into it, we're mm-hmm. jumping right in now. Relatives of the family had been insisting that authorities check on the family as they'd not heard anything from Dupont de Ligonnès. And it was the 21st of April and it was 15 days of not hearing from the family. So investigators, investigators went to check the house, which is where they discovered five bodies buried under the terrace of the family home.
Buried.
These were the bodies of Agnès, who was 48, Arthur, who was 21, Thomas, who was 18, Anne, who was 16, and Benoit, who was only 13. They also found the bodies of the family's two dogs.
Mm.
Yeah,
I hate when they kill the dogs.
Yeah.
I mean,
like, obviously, please don't kill the people either. Either but what
you
did the...
bring the dogs into it. They can't fucking they testify.
Just, I was about to say, so actually, that's not inappropriate. I was about to say, you know, dogs just be going around, you know, doing what dogs do. Dogs be dogging. But I realised the other, so moving swiftly along. All of which had died as the result of being shot. And they were buried under piles of rubble and quicklime. The only member of the household not found among the bodies was Xavier.
Papa.
Yes. So a search for the killer and for Xavier now began. Everyone was wondering what happened here. Is Xavier the killer and on the run? Or is he dead but his body is elsewhere? If Xavier is to blame, you know, did he act alone or have help? Mm-hmm. Why would someone decide, you know, just one day, oh, I'm just going to murder my whole family,
mm-hmm.
Including the dogs. This is kind of where we're going to move on to the timeline leading up to the discovery and mm-hmm. going on from the discovery. So kind of the whole scale of events. Now, what I do originally, because this isn't my first time looking into this case, because I remember, I don't know whenever it was, but I remember at one stage I watched Unsolved Mysteries on Netflix.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the episodes in the first volume that's on Netflix is this case.
Okay, see, I've never heard of this case.
Yeah, like now I've not rewatched the episode from Unsolved Mysteries to do my research for this case. I've done everything here kind of online. Wikipedia was very broad, especially for mm-hmm. the timeline, very helpful for the information for this. Now, but when I did originally kind of see the case on that time back maybe a year or two ago on Unsolved Mysteries, I kind of was of the opinion that it definitely had to be Xavier.
Okay.
Which is what it kind of already seems like. We haven't even got into anything.
His body he's the only one not there. They were buried under the family terrace. There was rubble and quicklime, which is used to kind of destroy evidence and kind of
degrade
the body
originally
quicker.
Where I was going. But throughout the whole case, it's like one minute I'm thinking him, the next minute I'm not. You know, it's a bit weird.
Let's get into it.
But that's where we end up touching off a conspiracy side of things.
Ah.
In a way.
Okay.
So, like I said, looking onto the timeline leading up to the discovery of the bodies, Xavier obtained a firearm license on the 2nd of February 2011. So, what's that? January, February, March? It's only a month, give or take,
before the murder.
This happened. On March 12th, 2011, Xavier bought rifle bullets. He registered at a shooting range to the north of Nantes, in which he visited four times between the 26th of March and the 1st of April. Yeah. So Thomas and Benoit had also begun to learn how to shoot, and Arthur was scheduled to start learning. A receipt was found at the family home for a DIY store that would have been a 3.5 hour drive away. That's definitely going out of your way, I'm sure. Yeah. When you're living in a city, that's definitely one nearer to you. Mm-hmm. So the receipt was dated to a Wednesday in late March, but not sure whether it's the 23rd or the 30th of March, but one of them.
Okay.
So this receipt listed multiple items purchased, including a roll of large bin liners, a box of adhesive plastic paving slabs. So someone's getting ready to make a make-do patio. God bless you.
Excuse me.
Yeah, plastic paving slabs. And on Friday, April 1st, the eldest child, Arthur, leaves his college where he was studying, but does not turn up at the pizzeria he worked at, even though he was due to collect his monthly wage. And Arthur's boss said that he was surprised by this and said...
Excuse me, sorry.
Allergies. And
I'm
said...
your bullshit.
Oh my God, rude. And this is only the beginning.
Yep.
And said that Arthur always came to collect his wage on the first day of the month, like, mm-hmm. religiously.
Okay,
so it was very strange that he hadn't showed up to collect the wage because, you know, it was always what he did. The next day, Saturday, April 2nd, Xavier buys 4 10-kilogram bags of lime from different shops in the area, so not all from the one shop. He's going out of his way to make it not look suspicious, I guess,
okay.
that he's buying so much. On Sunday, April 3rd, a neighbour of the family, Fabrice, sees Agnès for the last time. Soon after, he sees Xavier putting large bags into his car. Xavier and Agnès, as well as three of their children, supposedly dined in a restaurant and went to the cinema this day.
Okay.
At 10:37 p.m, Xavier calls his sister Christine, but it ends up going to voicemail and he left the following message. Now, obviously, he left it in French, mm-hmm. so this is the English translation. And if you're someone who... speaks and understands French and whatnot, you can actually listen to the voicemail that was left. It's available online.
But we have very basic French.
Yes. We spent our Sunday evening in the cinema together, then in a restaurant, and we've just got back. I'm just calling to ask if it's too late to speak to you on the phone, and now I see it's gone to voicemail. But I was surprised. You spoke to me about Bertram, who's getting ready for his flight, huh? But I thought he'd only just arrived, so I was a bit surprised. Anyway, sending you my love. If it's not too late, call me back or send me a text and I'll call you. Okay, I'm going to put the kids to bed. Say hi to everyone. See you soon. Maybe.
Weird.
That's
a weird way to end a voicemail.
Yeah.
Might see you soon, might
maybe.
Not. Feel cute, might be.
Like, I mean, I guess the one you think about it, like, if I was to, like, ring someone that I was related to or even ring one of you and I was like, oh, do you know, see you soon, maybe.
I'm one person.
It wouldn't be weird, you know, in the sense that, like, you know, might see you tomorrow, might be next week.
Yeah,
so it kind of isn't that weird of a thing to say, but it is a very weird thing to say given the events of what's happened. So it's like, is it coincidence or is that his way of being like, maybe,
feel cute, country later.
Might delete family.
Control, I'll delete the whole thing.
The recording of the message was publicly released in September 2019. On Monday the 4th of April, Anne and Benoit do not turn up at school, supposedly due to illness.
Mm-hmm.
Anne and Benoit's friends become concerned when they can't get in contact with them, and they recall a rumour about the family leaving for Australia where their job had got, where, you know, where I think we were said that Xavier's job had gotten like a job transfer. But obviously they find it strange that their friends had not told them about this departure themselves.
Yeah, like you would say goodbye to your friends.
Yeah, exactly.
Like if I was going to Australia in the morning, I would come and say goodbye to you, like goodbye to Dawn, like, you know.
Yeah, or at least family. If you even didn't get the chance to say goodbye, we'd know you're going from your mouth.
Yeah, give you a little FaceTime and be like, listen, I'm about to pop on a flight. Like, I'll give you a text when I land.
Yeah. Do you know, later. It's weird to not...
Hasta la pasta. Nice knowing you.
Yeah. So it's like... Yeah, they're finding it very strange and they've been attempting to contact Anne and Benoit both, you know, online and by text. But obviously, you know, they weren't getting any contact back. Xavier speaks with Christine, his sister, on the phone for about 20-30 minutes. And Christine later said everything seemed normal. Xavier goes for food with his son Thomas at a high-end restaurant in Avril. I hope I'm pronouncing that right. They arrive there at around 9 p.m. Xavier ordered a 35-hour tasting menu with half a bottle of Anjou Village Brissac red wine, which is one of the finest red wines from the Anjou district. Thomas had a sea bass dish and tomato juice, the bill coming to a total of €72.55 for the meal. The two waiters remember Thomas feeling unwell near the end of the meal, and that Xavier and Thomas barely spoke to each other during the meal.
Okay.
It is believed by investigators that Xavier murdered his wife and three of his children on the 3rd to the 4th of April, and then murdered his son Thomas on the night of the 5th of April. Now, neighbours of the family dispute these dates in relation to the death of Agnès, as they claim she was seen in front of her house on April 5th at some time around 12:15 to 12:30 in the day, and again on April 7th. So the prosecutors acknowledge that forensic experts were unable to narrow the exact date of death down because to a specific
quick,
day.
Because of the quick
line. So on top of this, an employee of a hairdressing salon near the family's house had also claimed to have seen Agnès on April 5th. And the employee stated, "I came to pick up my wages. It was a Tuesday. It was the 5th of April. I needed my wages. I saw her on the pavement. She was on her phone. And it was around 12:15 or 12:30. So it matches up with what the neighbour said.
Yep.
And Tuesday, April 5th, a bailiff comes to the family home to recover a debt of €20,000. But there is no answer. And I'm just kind of like, we've only just mentioned a while ago the expensive meal for two people. Yeah. So if you're on €20,000
like
a day,
you ordered a fancy wine.
Why are you off spending just under €74 on the finest wine? And obviously going to a relatively expensive place anyway, mm-hmm. in the sense of, like, the majority of that meal was the price of the wine, actually, really.
Probably, yeah.
But
then again, he spent €35 on a tasting board.
That was the wine, yeah.
Oh, okay.
It was the wine tester. But anyway, a friend of Thomas that studied music with him said that Thomas had spent Tuesday afternoon with him at the friend's home in Angers, where they played music and watched TV. Thomas was meant to spend the night at his friend's house, but received a call from Xavier asking him to return home as his mother had been in a cycling accident.
Okay.
Thomas quickly ate with his friend and then took a train home at about 10 p.m. And the next day, when the friend tried to reach Thomas, the responses he got were brief, such as, "I'm not coming to yours, I'm ill," and, "Really ill, I'm not coming to class." And obviously these were texts.
Okay.
2 days after, Thomas had left his friend's house. His friend got a text message from Thomas's phone saying, "I'm out of battery. My dad's looking for a new charger for me." I find that a bit sus, because I'm like, first of all, surely someone else in the house has a charger that'll fit your phone. Like, because most families tend to have the same brand phone.
There's six people in the house.
Yeah, like surely one of them has the same type of charger.
Yeah.
Like
there's six people in my family and we all have iPhones.
Now, I know now it's different in the sense of now all phones are chargers tend to have USB-C or the Lightning, or maybe some of them might have the slightly older Android charger. Whereas I know going back to when we were like younger, some of the phones had completely really weird charging connectors. So unless it was that kind of situation, but I don't know, still a bit odd to me. And you live in a city as well. You live in Nantes. Can you not go to the shop?
Yeah. Like, it's strange. And the fact that the text messages were so brief and just like, "I'm ill, I'm not coming to class."
It's basically piss off.
Yeah.
Like, do you know, and it's not the way you talk to your friend.
No.
Or you'd normally go into more detail.
Yeah.
And explain. But anyway, that is the last time that Thomas's friend heard from him, or from anyone in the family for that matter. An ex-girlfriend of Thomas, Pauline, remembers Thomas as a light-hearted, cheerful and happy guy. She said that they didn't date for long, but she described him as a really nice guy who always listened to what you had to say,
mm-hmm.
and that he was very close to his family and passionate about music and cinema. And it's not confusing me about all this as well, because they do genuinely seem like they are a very close family,
yeah.
and that they do a lot together, and do you know, the grass seems quite green.
Yeah.
Pauline also said that she had spoken to him via Facebook on Tuesday, April 5th, while he was at his friend's house, and that he seemed odd in how he was texting when he told her his father had said that his mother had been in a cycling accident, and that Thomas had to return home that same evening. Do you know, I don't know what she means by odd,
okay.
but just that maybe his phrasing and the way he was coming across just didn't
just
seem
a bit off.
Off. Yeah. It didn't seem on par with how he normally is. Now, do you know, maybe that's because he believed that his mother had been in a cycling accident,
maybe
and he was a bit
worried,
concerned, you know, or worried.
A bit preoccupied.
But I suppose that's to be expected.
Yep.
So on top of this, she said that Monday the 4th of April, only one day before, that she noticed Thomas seemed lonely and he had told her that he would skip classes on Wednesday to come to a music rehearsal, but he did not turn up at the rehearsal.
Okay.
Which she said again was not like him. During this week, neighbours had heard the family dogs howling for two nights in a row and then never heard them again.
Interesting.
So yeah. And then on Wednesday, April 6th, Arthur's girlfriend, who was worried after not having heard from him, goes to the family home and knocks on the door where a light was on the first floor, but she said the family's two dogs did not bark when she knocked. And I'm assuming by feeling the need to specifically mention that, that the dogs would normally bark if someone's at the door. So they weren't.
The dogs were probably
This was obviously, the yeah, the dogs were probably bodies out the back or bodies in the house at this point, depending.
Puppies.
Thursday the 7th of April, Xavier is seen making multiple return trips from the family house to his car, loading the car with large bags. A neighbour also claims to have spoken to Agnès on this day. The neighbour claims that on April 7th they saw Agnès walking her dog, that they spoke briefly, and then the neighbour cut the conversation short as they had an important appointment to get to. Now, this same neighbour spoke to RTL, which is a French radio station located in Paris, on the condition that they remain anonymous, saying, quote, "The newspapers say the autopsies put her dead on the 4th, but I'm almost convinced I saw her on the evening of Thursday 7th, because I know I didn't have much time to speak to her as I pick up my son from the childminder every Thursday evening." Now, what I think is weird about this, though, is why were the dogs howling for 2 days?
Stopped
and then someone sees, you know, Agnès walking the dog. I think that I don't think this person's necessarily lying, but I think they might have they just might have their dates mixed up.
Maybe.
Because I don't see why the dogs would howl for 2 days straight for no reason
and then stop
not let out some sort of noise. Yeah. Unless that was when they'd been killed.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that she might have just got muddled up on days. Possibly, but yeah. I'm not completely ruling out that Agnès wasn't around on that day, but I can't see why the dog would be with her, and why one instead of two.
Yeah.
Excuse me. A report from Envoyé Spécial, Special Correspondent is in English, by Anne-Sophie Martin, which was aired on October 24th, 2013, stated that more than 2 years after the events, that this neighbour was still convinced she was that she'd seen Agnès on the 7th. The report also revealed another witness who agreed with this, a saleswoman friend of Agnès, who stated that she saw her in her shop on either Thursday 7th or Friday 8th of April. So again, you know, I'm not against the possibility that Agnès is still alive at this point, but the dog thing, I just doesn't sit with me.
Yeah, it throws me, yeah.
On Friday the 8th of April, Xavier went online for the last time from the IP address of the family home to write on a Catholic online forum. He also sends an email to his brother-in-law, which is Christine's husband, saying, "Everything's fine, Bertram. You'll hear more detailed news soon through Christine. Bye for now. All the best, Xavier."
Okay.
But I'm like, hear more detail through Christine. What does Christine know, supposedly?
Yeah. Like, it is a strange... email to send,
and again, maybe it's the way it translates or something, you know, but it's still, even if you like put that in a different way, like, so far there's been no mention of anything actually going on at all to, you know, need to be explained in further detail. And then, like, to say you'll hear news when the dogs are clearly more than likely already dead. Someone else, if not all of the other people in the house, are probably already dead at this point, so it's just strange to me. A message is also sent to Xavier's mother and sister from the family home's IP address Monday, April 11th. Anne and Benoit's school receives a letter signed by Xavier stating that they will be leaving the school and that the family will be moving to Australia due to urgent professional changes. As well as this, the Catholic school where Agnès works receives a letter of resignation stating the same reason for leaving. The headmaster is unable to get in contact with her by phone. A typed and unsigned letter. Now, I don't get why this one's not signed, because all the other ones have been. But a typed and unsigned letter dated the 11th of April. Now, I did read that it's possible this was dated after it was wrote.
Right.
So, like, the date it was wrote might not be the date on it.
Okay.
So, it was dated the 11th of April anyway, and is sent to the immediate family of Xavier. And this letter claims that after having worked covertly for the DEA, the American Drug Enforcement Administration, that the entire family has had to move to the United States as part of a witness protection program, and that nobody would be able to contact him for a few years. He advises that his relatives circulate reports on social media that the family has moved to Australia. There is no proof, however, that this letter was actually written by Xavier.
Okay, and also, if you're in the witness protection program, you can't tell anyone.
But I assume that's why they're... If that's to be said as the truth,
yeah,
they're telling everyone in Australia, except breaking the rule in terms of immediate family, like mother.
Okay, yeah, fair enough, but...
Which you aren't really supposed to either,
yeah,
but...
Yeah, you wouldn't put that in writing. Like, you would maybe go see
But then
her.
Again, there's nothing normal going on here.
Yeah, it's a very... It's a very convoluted case. Like, it's very weird.
Yeah. But anyway, as I said, though, they don't know for sure. There's no proof that that letter was written by Xavier, that one was. Xavier spends the night of the 11th to the 12th of April at Hotel Premier Classe in Blagnac. I don't know if I'm pronouncing that right at all. And he pays for the stay with credit card before leaving in his car, which is a Citroen C5. On Tuesday, 12th of April, Xavier spends the night of the 12th to the 13th of April. I'm at the Auberge de Cassagne in La Pote in southeastern France. Again, if anyone who understands French is listening and I'm butchering these names, I do apologise. Under the false name Mr. Laurent Xavier.
Okay.
Again, pays by credit card. Wednesday, 13th of April is when neighbours in Nantes become concerned and contact the police. The shutters of the house have been closed for over a week and Agnes's car has been outside on the street the entire time.
Okay, has it moved?
No, exactly. So they're like... What's going on? Xavier spends the night of the 13th to the 14th of April at Hotel La Seine in southeastern France. He had lived in this town in the 1980s and a former girlfriend from when Xavier lived there informed the police that Xavier had contacted her that evening, but they did not meet. And then Thursday the 14th of April, Xavier takes €30 out of an ATM in Rockburn, also in Argens. Xavier also spends the night here at the Hotel Formula One, where he is seen on CCTV. This is the last known sighting of him. On Tuesday 19th of April, an investigation was opened, and that was when the DIY material Xavier purchased came to light. And then we're moving on to Thursday 21st of April, which is when a wanted notice is issued for the entire family. It is during the day that the investigators uncover the remains of the children and Agnes under the patio in the back garden, along with the family's two dogs. During the night of April 21st to April 22nd, Xavier's Citroen is found in the car park of the Formula One hotel by police that were equipped with a number plate recognition system. A Pontiac that was also being looked for has not been found to this day.
Okay.
Investigators looked towards monasteries. It was speculated that Xavier could have withdrawn to a monastery where he would have been, you know, afforded or given discretion.
Yep.
On April 22nd.
Sanctuary.
Yeah, basically. On April, did I say 22nd?
Yep.
Yeah, autopsy showed that the victims had been drugged and then shot dead with a 22 long rifle as they slept. Xavier did in fact have a weapon of this calibre that he had inherited from his father only 3 weeks before the murders.
Okay.
Suspicious. Now, the prosecutor in Nantes say that he will allow the victims to be buried in the next few days. The relatives are advised not to view the bodies. And so combined with that and the surprisingly fast speed of the process, this has actually led Xavier's relatives to believe that the bodies recovered are not those of Agnes and her children. They don't believe the two of them. Between how fast everything was done and whatnot.
Then who else could it be, and why would the police try to cover it up?
Unless the drug thing and witness protection program was the truth. That's where that's kind of where there's a bit of conspiracy to it.
Okay.
On this date, an arrest warrant is also issued to locate Xavier in order to obtain witness testimony from him about the murders. The family's funeral was held on April 28th. Do you see how fast that is like?
Yeah, that is quite quick.
Especially given the circumstances.
Yeah.
At 2:30 PM at St. Felix Church in Nantes. I'm just like, the spelling doesn't add up in English. But this is a church that the family had frequented and where Benoit was an altar server.
Mm-hmm.
1,400... My speech is just really broken right now. Apologies, guys. I think the second part of the hangover is flaring.
Yep.
But anyway, 1,400 people attended the funeral. The family had requested a simple ceremony with no flowers or wreaths. Significant security was provided for the funeral. After the ceremony, the bodies were cremated and then buried on Saturday, April 13th at 10:30 a.m. in Noyers, Sur Serine in East Central France, the place that Agnes's family had originated from. One company that Xavier founded, NetSurf Concept LLC, that was recorded on the commercial register in Florida in the States. Xavier's advisor was Gerard Corona, an immigrant of French origin. Now, Corona specializes in assisting foreigners with administrative and legal procedures in the United States. So, and he also helps clients to open foreign bank accounts and obtain anonymous bank cards that allows them to withdraw money anywhere in the world without leaving a trace. It has been speculated that Xavier could have used these services in order to disappear.
Mm-hmm. He had the means, he had the
existence. Had the money and everything, and then this guy that he knows, you know. So multiple searches were carried out in the Massif de Mauresse area,
mm-hmm.
but nothing was found here. Prosecutor Brigitte Lamy has not reconsidered Xavier's status as a suspect and is indeed inclined to believe that he did commit suicide, and that if his body is to be found and there are no other suspects, the investigation would be closed.
Okay.
In mid-July 2015, a journalist in Nantes received a photograph that had "I'm still alive" written on the back, and the picture showed Arthur and Benoit sitting at a kitchen table. It's unknown who took and sent the picture.
Okay.
On January 9th, 2018, a monastery was raided after multiple worshippers claimed they had seen Xavier there. The police later concluded it was a case of mistaken identity and that the person people had believed to be Xavier was actually a monk who looked like him.
Fabulous.
Xavier's sister Christine cites on her blog that difficulties faced by a person burying five people underneath the garden patio, and she's providing photos of where the bodies were discovered and states how the space is just under 4 feet high, meaning that the killer would have had to be working on their hands and knees,
mm-hmm.
Without long tools, which I guess would imply the shovel and the hoe that Xavier had supposedly bought at some point just before the murders would not really have been any use.
Okay.
For the disposal of bodies if he was the killer. Christine also says that no displaced earth was found in the garden, which would mean the perpetrator would have had to use the tarpaulin, moved 5 tons of earth by hand, left absolutely no trace of this moved earth. That's a bit hard to do. Furthermore, Christine claims that Xavier suffered from neck and back problems and because of this would not have been physically capable of such a task.
Okay.
Now, lastly, it is said that due to the low headroom, the person would likely have both banged their head and rubbed their hair on the ceiling repeatedly.
So there would be forensics.
But no human skin cells, blood or DNA were found there. Police have gotten more than 900 reports from people who believe that they have spotted Xavier. The most notable sighting being someone matching Xavier's description being caught on CCTV in a casino in Neuilly-les-Bains. Another interesting piece of information to note is that in 2004, writing on the French online medical forum Doctissimo, Agnes had actually described the difficulties she and her husband faced and stated, now bear in mind what happened in 2011, wasn't it?
Mm-hmm.
And this was in 2004, stating that her husband, Xavier, had commented to her that a group debt as a family would not be a catastrophe.
What the fuck does that mean?
Yeah. Which is basically what happened, except for Xavier in the end. But yeah. this was 7 years after that, 2004, 2011. Yeah. And what exactly happened has never been established, but the prime suspect is considered to be Xavier, and there has been an international arrest warrant for him since. And that's the story of the Dupont de Ligonnès murders and disappearance. He's still not been found to this day.
That's a weird one. That is a bizarre nobody, case.
Nothing like that. Now, there has been bodies found at points, but nothing has ever been confirmed that it could be him. They don't know. So he's very much, could very well still be alive because he would be in his 60s now, I think.
Yeah.
So
that's a wild one.
It's just very weird, and I'm just kind of fair. I think it's the families, the relatives that are obviously alive, like they said, they never saw the bodies.
Yeah, no.
The process of the funeral is ridiculously fast.
I do think they maybe could have been told not to view the bodies because the quicklime would have sped up the rate of decomposition and they would have looked horrific.
But you'd wonder, I'm like, but at the end of the day, I'm like, even if the even if they died on the 4th or the 5th.
Five autopsies and the burial and cremation to happen in the space of what, six
basically,
days?
We'll say within a week, basically.
A week, like, it's crazy.
Yeah.
Because it takes about a week here for one.
Yeah, and like, as well, I don't know, I'm assuming, obviously.
That is Ireland, I know, versus France, but.
Yeah, exactly. I know every country's different, but as well, they have a lot more higher population. Mm-hmm. So, like, there would be, obviously, with that higher population comes more people dying.
Yeah.
More closer together, so weird. I imagine.
And then, like you were saying, that space under the terrace is about 4 foot high, was it?
Yeah.
So, like, I'm 5 foot, just one on 5 foot nine.
And how was there no displaced art?
And, like,
how would one man do
struggle
that?
Because I would literally have to be bent in half, and then you have to, like,
I'd have to shuffle on the floor.
Yeah, and then he'd have to drag each
body
in.
It almost seems like,
without leaving any trace that he was in that area.
Yeah.
Because there was no skin cells, no blood.
And even with
hair.
Him, you know what? Yeah, but even if it was him, it wouldn't make a big deal if he got blood or skin cells on anything.
Yeah.
Because it's his house.
Exactly.
So skin cells and stuff that have been found there could just, you know, if he was ever to be found, he could just explain it away and be like, well, I have been under there before because it's my house. I've done stuff, you know, like, you know, just checking. So, you know, you could bullshit your way. Up
through
something,
it, yeah.
You know, maybe it wouldn't be the most believable, but like there is ways to explain why your DNA as a member of the household could be there.
Like, it's just, it's weird. It's a weird
one. It seems like
the timeline being so convoluted and so all over the place, and people, like pathologists saying, oh, they died between the 4th and the 5th.
But then people claiming to have seen.
And then people saying, oh, I saw her on the 7th.
Yeah, but it's like, then again, but then what I was wondering with all of that is, I was like, if those dates are correct for when the children died,
yeah,
that means Agnès was still alive while all her children were dead.
Yeah, which,
so where does she tie into it? Was she involved? Why did she, you know, like it doesn't make sense that.
By all accounts, it seemed like she really loved her kids. So, like, surely people who had seen her on those dates when the kids would have been dead would have noticed that she was grieving or that she was scared or that she was going through something.
Yeah, or that she might have been in some way erratic or something.
Yeah, because I don't see how you could go to the hair salon knowing that your four children are dead.
Well, no, she didn't go to the hair salon.
Or be seen near a hair salon.
But no, see, someone who works at a hair salon near
the
house saw her outside on the street somewhere.
I don't see how you could be out and about walking, you know, doing whatever, knowing that your four children are dead. Now, I know, like, you never really know what goes on behind closed doors, and...
But then I wonder, I'm like, if, let's, like, going to, like, being a bit of a conspiracy theorist about it, but, like, if, let's say, something similar to the whole witness protection was true,
mm-hmm.
maybe she was spotted after that date because the kids were the first to be moved to this new place, then she followed, and then he came last on his own, leaving
maybe
a trail along France until he disappeared. So anyone else that was looking for him, not the police.
Because I was thinking those bags, the bin bags that the neighbour saw him putting into the car, could have been their belongings that they were taking with them.
Yeah.
But then I don't know if it was said anywhere, if there was things
missing. No, no one said.
But I suppose if it is a case of witness protection, police wouldn't state, like they wouldn't come out and state, well, they took their clothes or they took their dogs or they took this, that and the other.
Because, like, I suppose if it's witness protection, that would also be, like, more than likely collaborated between the governments in such a case as this.
But then I'm also like, if it was witness protection, why come up with a story like this? Why plaster his face on the newspapers,
have their faces
out there, have people knowing what they look like, people looking out for him, if the idea is for them to be in witness protection?
It defeats the purpose. The ends don't justify the means, kind of thing.
Exactly, because people are going to be looking out for them. And, like, there's true crime people, there's true crime fanatics all over the world, especially in the US. Most of the YouTubers that I watch with true crime are based in the US.
Yeah.
They would see this story, and then they would be covering this story, and then it raises awareness, and their pictures are everywhere, and people know what they look like.
Yeah. It's very weird. Like,
it's a very weird case.
And like I said, he still hasn't been found to this day. So I'm like, where is this man? Is he alive? Is he dead?
Don't honestly know what to make of this one.
But I'm like, what I don't get is if he did, let's say, you know, if he was the one that did it all, and like, I suppose that's the most logical explanation. And then he went off and let's say he did end up killing himself.
Mm-hmm.
Why not just kill yourself in the house to be discovered alongside the family? But then, I suppose, one of the last places he was sighted in France was his hometown.
Yeah.
So you got that, I suppose, like we said in the Malaysian thing, when the plane was flying, you've got that nostalgia.
Yeah.
That kind of like going back to where you came from. Like a last look at home. So like, there's that. But again, no body's been found that can be definitely said to be his. So he's very much probably, he could very well be alive, living his best life. Well, as best you can live after murdering your whole family.
Because like, I know there's a similar enough case in the States where similar situation, it was the mom, the dad, and they had two young children, I think. I don't remember names, but I know they had, like, they were living a certain type of lifestyle, like kind of a more luxurious lifestyle.
And right. Then
debt started to come in.
And that's where it all goes wrong. Money
started to go low, but instead of adjusting and readjusting their lifestyle to match their new income, they kept the father basically kind of hid this from the mother and kept living this luxurious lifestyle to the point where the debt was so severe that he decided it was best to kill his wife and their two young kids, hide their bodies, and just take off. Now, I'm pretty sure he was caught and he was arrested and sent to prison for it, but a lot of the time
I just don't understand, like, if your reason for snapping is, you know, the pressure of debt and not wanting to change what's going on and stuff like that, which, you know, I get, nobody likes change and likes the income going down or anything like that, but I'm like, why in the name of God would you, like, because obviously if you're doing it, if the way you're seeing it is you're doing it is because you don't want them to have to live a life they're not used to, then in a kind of twisted way you're doing it in a way because in some sort of sense you care, because you don't want them to have to live a life of, I suppose, poverty.
It's weird because
But how can you manage to kill them if you care?
This is the common thing with family annihilators, because that is
what this case seems to be
is a family annihilation, where in this case the patriarch, the dad, has decided for whatever reason this is the best course of action for his family. And like, I don't personally understand it, and you,
well,
don't
Tanya, to be honest, if you did understand it, I wouldn't be having you in my house, because I think that would all be
scared. Quite a common thing with family annihilation is that one person, family, decides this is the best course of action is for everyone to die rather than
adapt
or live with the consequences. Or like in that case with that guy in the States, I'm pretty sure he just didn't want his wife to find out that they were in such a large amount of debt.
Yeah.
Have
you ever heard of filing for bankruptcy, love?
Yeah, or
killing yourself.
Don't be a murderer.
And not bring the whole family with you.
Fucking weird. This one, I don't...
But I don't get it. Like, I feel like if I was to ever snap and, like, murder my whole family, I would definitely kill myself.
Oh, yeah. When you come down afterwards, you have to be like, oh, my God, what have I done?
Like, I couldn't just be like, right, so that's that. I'm off.
Kill the whole family. I'm off to Australia.
Love a McDonald's.
Would love a McPlant, so I would.
You know, bit of veggie dipper. An apple pie.
You can't even have the apple pie.
Well, I can in a vegan point of view, but I can't from a gluten point of view. But that didn't stop me the last time. But but anyhow, so yeah, that is the case of the murders of the Dupont de Ligonnès family and the disappearance of Xavier Dupont de Ligonnès.
And the murder of the dogs.
And the dogs.
Don't forget the dogs.
But they are Dupont de Ligonnès dogs.
Yes.
They were family. Bless them. I always get actually nearly more pissed off about people hurting and murdering an animal than I do about a person. And I'm like, it's just that, like, whatever an animal does, it's always kind of going to be innocent, because whatever it does, it's just its nature.
Yeah.
Whatever a human does, they have more, like, animals are conscious and whatnot, and they can think and stuff. But I feel like, obviously, people have more free will, in a sense. Do you get what I mean?
For me, it's the fact that dogs can't really defend themselves. Like, fair enough, the family were drugged and they were...
Yeah, like, a dog could defend itself against a dog, but like, it can't defend itself against a fucking gun.
Yeah, like, if the family...
What's it going to do, whip out a knife and go, come at me, bruv? No, it's not.
But, like, with the family, if they had been conscious, they probably would have been able to fight back to some extent. Now, it probably wouldn't have done them much good against a gun, in fairness, but like...
Yeah, but I wonder...
Dogs, bruh.
How did no one hear a gun go off?
Silencer, maybe?
But like...
Sure, it's a rifle. Can you put a silencer
on? That's what I'm thinking. It was a 22 caliber.
It's a long rifle. Like, I don't think you can put a silencer on a rifle.
Hang on, I'm going to Google it right now, because that's what I want to know. Like, and even if you can, would it still not make that kind of pew noise, just not really echoey? And I suppose if you're sleeping next door, if it was a bit late, then you might not.
Ratatata.
Then again, could have put a pillow over them and shot you the pillow as well.
Or, yeah, like, I don't know, it's a fucking weird case. This one's going to keep me up tonight.
But it's just... It's weird. I must watch more on it because I'm like, I've kind of got everything there, like, really, like the majority of it and the timeline and everything. But like, it's just something that you can kind of hear stuff about and then watch more documentaries and stuff on, because it's just so boggling.
Yeah,
and I still just don't understand how it's 2022 and there is still no sign of a body of this man.
It is very hard to disappear these days.
Like, everything's online.
Yeah, everything's online. You can't...
Well, even if it just ends up, you're walking past someone and you end up in the background of their Instagram selfie. Do you know what I mean?
Exactly. Or CCTV. There's fucking CCTV everywhere these days.
It's like, where are you?
Like, it's not like this happened in the 1900s where it was easy to just leave the country, leave the county, the state, whatever. The province, I think it is in France.
What did we say it was? It was a rifle, wasn't it?
A rifle. It was a 22 caliber long rifle. But, like, back then it would have been a lot easier to disappear. In like, you know, the 1900s or whatever, but like, this is in like 2007.
You can get a silencer, I think.
Really? That's fucking fascinating.
Can you tell we don't really have guns that much in Ireland?
Yeah, we have gun control. It's great.
It is. It is indeed.
Even the police aren't armed here. There's the armed response unit.
Yeah, like, so they're there if they're needed, but they're not just, you know, like fucking...
I'm sure someone's house got raided by the armed response recently enough in town.
A few.
Madness.
But yeah, no, there's always something. My brother has awoken from his slumber. I hear movement. Anyway, so with that, I guess we've just been rambling really for the last few minutes, to be honest. The case is well and truly over now. So yeah, if you guys have any, I suppose, suggestions for cases you'd like to see covered, interesting conspiracies, if you just want to get in touch, send us a message, anything like that, find us on Instagram, Twitter, at Twisted Talks Pod. We're on Facebook, Twisted Talks Pod as well, but the name of the page is Twisted Talks, but if you want to look it up through Facebook with the username, it's at Twisted Talks Pod. And yeah, you can also use the link in the description if you want to send us a voice message. What else? Give us a 5-star review, guys. Leave a nice little comment on Apple Podcasts. And if you don't have Apple Podcasts or anything like that and you enjoy the podcast, feel free to post about us on your socials and, you know, share us with people you think might be interested, or
talk to us. We're lonely.
You know, you know, we literally look forward to hearing from you, hopefully. Yeah. You know, I'm quite hungry now and half asleep after all that, so it is time to make food, and until the next time,
au revoir
ciao.